Hey, Weequay, give me a beer.
Am I the only one who liked the episode?
Give me some more stormtroopers.
Tie up the banthas to the stick.
Sand people are villains.
Enough of Tatooine. Let's go someplace else.
Before listening to this show, you should watch The Marshal, Chapter 9 of The Mandalorian on Disney+. Spoilers ahead. Hello, welcome to Galactic Initiative. I'm your host, Jeff. For this episode, David, Sean, and I discuss the opening of Season 2 only one day removed. The flow was free and unprepared instead of chronological and researched like our other shows. We will review the chapters in Season 2 with our usual style later. The observations and opinions expressed one day after the premiere and without the context of future chapters might be short-sighted. If so, we appreciate your indulgence. From the droid Gotra to crate pearls, we couldn't mention everything. That said, enjoy the show.
Your marshal wears Mandalorian armor.
Stream of consciousness is fine if that's what we want to do. I have notes.
All right. Yeah, I'm cool. I got notes too.
Believe it or not, I also took notes. Mining collective question mark?
Power hates a vacuum.
Mm.
On the night of the destruction of the second Death Star.
That town and that whole situation and Cobb, the Marshal, and Boba Fett's armor. It all comes from the Aftermath trilogy. That whole thing, that entire scenario, flashback, the whole setup, the whole scene, that's all taken out of the Chuck Wendig books. But they weren't actually the Mining Collective. They were the Red Key Raiders or something like that. They're another crime syndicate that dressed up like miners. It's seemed a little, you know, for an hour-long episode where we spent 20 minutes watching a line of Tusken Raiders walk through the desert, we probably could have spent a little more time establishing that timeline.
Speaking of the Tusken Raider thing, I have never, ever fast-forwarded through an episode. I hit the 10-second button like 5 times.
Like when they were walking around or when they were,
yes!
When they were sitting around talking?
No, when they were walking around. Enough of Tatooine. Let's go someplace else.
No, here's the thing is that we just keep going back and going back and going back. We've taken this massive galaxy and we've really made it tiny. The entire overarching story of the Mandalorian and the child was the first 5 minutes of the episode. Find the remaining Mandalorians that have been scattered to the galaxy. Okay, great. Well, we already established that at the end of the last episode of the last season. Then you take 50 minutes and you have more Tusken Raider talk and we go back and we have a minute with the lady at Mos Eisley. But when they announced that all these episodes were going to be twice as long or almost twice as long as they were last season, I was excited because one of the things we have talked about on our previous reviews of the show is, you know, we would like a little bit more. But now I'm thinking, you know, maybe we should keep them to 30 minutes because it keeps their narrative style and the story focused.
Be careful what you wish for, because my goodness, montage after montage after montage. I agree with Sean. I mean, sometimes less is better. I mean, it's just basically just the same start that we had with Season 1, Episode 1. He gets in a fight, takes care of business, and then walks out, and here we go on our adventure. Yeah, and aren't the Gamorrean guards supposed to be fat?
Maybe that's what they look like when they work out.
Well, and then the fighting style. I mean, you see the clink-cling and nothing happened. Were they blocking every time?
The axes had some kind of force field.
Yeah, there was something going on there. There was like glow or something.
Or got close, I guess.
That's another ripoff of Dune.
Tremors/Dune.
The crate dragon. Bless the maker in his passing. He who controls the spice controls the universe.
Am I the only one who liked the episode?
Well, define like. I didn't cancel my Disney subscription, so yeah. Technically I liked it. I just felt like it was a rehash of the Mudhorn episode. We'll accept no dissension in the ranks. We are hegemon. There is one voice.
I think we can all agree on this point. Not what we expected.
Facts.
Correct.
This felt like an episode in the middle of last season, after the stakes and the main storyline had been established.
I mean, I get the fact going back to Tatooine was necessary, but my bigger question is, do the Mandalorians really know where the child is from? The clan knows where the child is from?
There might be a connection in the history of the Mandalorians that can lead Din Djarin to the Jedi. The conversation with the armor from last season puts the Mandalorian on the trail of these sorcerers known as Jedi, and perhaps the two are connected in that Din Djarin needs to work his way from covert to covert until he finds Mandalorians who can point him in the direction of the Jedi.
I mean, obviously they've had dealings with the Jedi, so yes, that would make sense, what you just described, Jeff.
Okay, so there's a little mission creep there. The ancient stuff tells of Mandalore the Great, the first Mandalorian to become a Jedi, and his battles with the Jedi, or the history of the Mandalorian people once battling the Jedi. This all happened in the days of yore. So my concern is, you start going around the galaxy and asking Mandalorians, they're only just going to tell you the same story. Well, that doesn't help us.
And all the Mandalorians we've seen in the Clone Wars are up to date on all of that history, and they've dealt with modern Jedi.
They were around 20 minutes ago. They've been around a lot longer than the Empire. How come everybody has forgotten? I'm having a problem with this timeline, the way that everybody acts. The Jedi are so lost and gone. It's like everybody knows they were purged. I mean, the Emperor made a live announcement, like, let this be a lesson to you, galaxy. That wasn't too long ago. The Order 66 happened 17 years before Episode 4. So we're talking, you know, not even a generation. There's people in this current universe who knew of Jedi. And you think Cara Dune, she was fighting the war. She knows about Luke. You can't be in the rebellion and not know about Luke. The other frustration is that, okay, so whatever the answer to that question is, what is our quest? We didn't get answered, or it didn't get advanced in any appreciable way. At the end of this episode, what did we learn? We are still at the same spot that we were at the beginning of the episode. What's the next clue? What's his next destination? Where is he going to go? We have now spent 1/8 of our season, and we've done nothing to advance the story.
The armor is the story, and Boba Fett, he escaped the Sarlacc pit, and the other stuff is just noise, as far as I'm concerned.
I think it's too early to say. What if Boba Fett becomes a main character in the show?
Lucas has been running around telling everybody that Boba Fett and Jango Fett aren't Mandalorians. And he said,
the armor is made of Beskar.
Now, because Dave and friends have decided, but
it's convenient.
Well, yeah, but we established this was coming in the previous season, right? We saw the mysterious person showing up in the desert on Tatooine. The real reason why he's stuck there is because the Jawas took his ship and they parted it out. Slave One has been reduced to pieces.
Yeah, what happened to Slave One?
And what happened to Jabba's Palace? What happened to all that? I mean, do you guys happen to know if Jabba's Palace is near that area? I mean, I don't know the geography of Tatooine probably as well as either one of you, but if Jabba's Palace is in that vicinity, that is maybe where he could be hanging out.
Well, in the Legends series, Jabba's Palace is retaken by the Bomar monks. They were the original owners of the palace. The monk's consciousness is actually in the glass jars carried around by those robot spiders.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
They get rid of what's left of Jabba's crew.
But Legends is no more.
Agreed? Right, but in the Aftermath novels, with Cobb and crew in that town are raising a hutlet that they hope will take over, like, family control of the planet, because apparently, like, the Hutt Syndicate still claim control over Tatooine. It's almost like a sidebar, like, one-off comment that Cobb makes.
Right.
There's speculation that the school is where the Hutlet is. Like, everybody's gone back to the books now and pulled all this information out. They're like, well, where's this and where's that? Well, they use it. And it's like, okay, you know that these guys aren't going to do a one-to-one pull, but they took enough of it. I mean, they lifted enough of it to where people are like, oh, you know, when are we going to get the reveal of that? It's like, I don't want to see Tatooine again this season. I'm sorry.
With Cobb, I don't think we've seen the last of him.
He'll be.
If he becomes a main character, then you can't say that this episode was for nothing. That's my point. It's just too early. I think Cobb will play at least as big a role as Cara Dune.
Yeah, and I think Mando is he's getting his own group of people together, and then's gonna take on the Empire in some way, but. Yeah, I don't think we've seen the end of Tatooine, Sean. I think we at least have one, maybe two more episodes of Tatooine.
The next episode might open on Tatooine.
Wow. Okay, so question regarding the armor. Do you think he bartered with the Jawas to get food, supplies, something to survive?
I would speculate that he was found unconscious in the desert and the Jawas took it. Here's the thing, you know, say what you want about whether or not, you know, Boba Fett is a Mandalorian. That's his dad's armor. He's not going to give that up.
I agree. I don't think the Jawas found him, and that could explain the 4 to 5 years on Tatooine as well. Perhaps he was captured.
They could have just stripped his armor and moved on, and then somebody else could have found him and nursed him back to health.
Sure.
You know,
sure.
So if some Cyclops on some other planet somewhere knows that there's a Mandalorian wandering around on Tatooine, then somebody on Tatooine should know that there's a Mandalorian wandering around on Tatooine, right? And so why hasn't he gone and got his armor yet? That would have taken 15 minutes because everybody knows exactly where Cobb is and what he's doing. This episode raises a lot more questions than it answers. And I am cautiously optimistic because we have not been let down by Favreau and Filoni yet.
Definitely. Yeah, I mean, we could just play the what-if game. Hopefully it'll be explained to us. But you guys aren't excited about the return of Boba Fett?
Oh, he's a very cool-looking character. I just think that the Clone Wars show made me more of a fan of Mandalorians and less of a fan of Boba Fett because we got whiny teenage Boba Fett in that show.
I confess, I don't love the portrayal of Boba Fett in the Clone Wars.
Well, it was unfortunate, too, that the cool episodes at the end of Clone Wars all got canceled and didn't get made into shows because we would have had the great showdown between him and Cad Bane. Right. I think that would have done a lot for the character.
He'd matured.
Right. Yeah. A more familiar Boba Fett.
Yeah, like Sean said, he's cool looking, but as far as I was concerned, he was dead. And it's kind of exciting, but fan service. I guess I just need to wait and see the rest of the backstory. What has he been doing for the last 4 years?
It does raise a lot of questions about Mandalorian culture, the significance of the armor. Can you take your helmet off? Can't you take your helmet off? Why would one group of Mandalorians follow the way and others wouldn't? With Boba Fett being the first Mandalorian in the series, since then, Mandalorian culture has gone in many different directions.
I still think that the group that Din Djarin is a part of is a fundamentalist, hardcore Mandalorian group because we do have a lot of material that would indicate to us not wearing a helmet is not that big of a deal. We have all of those seasons of the Clone Wars and Rebels. Bo-Katan, the last known leader of the Mandalorians as a planet, the last Mandalorian to have possession of the Darksaber, walked around with her helmet off all the time. So my hope is that we are going to get more of what the Purge was all about and what the result of that was and why now we have this helmet problem, you know?
Right.
But these are the things that I don't mind them spending an hour on.
Give me regular reports, please.
For you, what was the most, I mean, obviously the end reveal, what else was entertaining to you?
I'm just so excited to have Boba Fett back in Star Wars. Call it fan service. These guys might be the two greatest bounty hunters in the galaxy, and it would be fun to see them competing on some level, in some way.
Maybe Boba Fett steals the child?
Bounty hunters competing for bounties. That's like a completely different show. Like, if you want to just make this a show about bounty hunters, the greatest bounty hunters in the guild competing against each other, getting after each other, like, that would be a fantastic show in and of itself.
Yeah,
but the problem is when you introduce Boba Fett, we have shifted focus. How do we pay that off in such a way that we still make meaningful progress on the Yoda story, We make meaningful progress on locating other Mandalorians, right? And then how do we make Boba Fett's interaction believable without being distracting?
Going back to Moff Gideon, I want more of that. I almost think that they're getting to a point where it's almost too much.
I love the character of Cobb Vanth. I love the series Justified. I really like Timothy Oliphant as an actor, bringing him in and giving him a really cool role. So put all that together, I was thoroughly entertained.
Fair enough. Sean, what about you? What excited you about this episode?
Cobb's speeder bike is made up of one half of Anakin's pod racer.
Yes.
Yep.
Yes.
I'm having a very hard time with it. I think maybe the beginning, the Cyclops and the skinny Gamorreans, that was probably the most entertaining. And then the creatures that ate the guy.
I believe the creatures are Furnox. First in Rebels. The Rebels are going back to an old Clone Wars fort.
Oh, those things.
Hoping to gather supplies. Yeah, they can't come into the light. Then the fort, the last season of Clone Wars, is part of the Battle of Anaxes where the Bad Batch comes in. Problem is, I've played the episode slowly and gone frame by frame on a really big screen. I just can't make out the creatures.
I would wager, I'm not necessarily a betting man, but I would probably feel pretty confident putting a buck on the fact that that's what they are. I mean, it would make sense if we extrapolate from what we've seen before with Filoni and his proclivities to pulling things out of his TV shows and putting them in this one. Everything he's ever been involved in on any level is being heavily featured in his shows.
A lot of people who haven't either watched Rebels or Clone Wars, and now you've got this live action opportunity to represent some of this stuff. I think that's maybe what they're trying to do.
Yeah, I mean, that whole first, to maybe focus on that for a second, that entire intro where he's walking down the street, all that graffiti. If you look at that graffiti, there's all kinds of stuff in there. Vader, and there's stormtroopers, and there's a Chewbacca in there. There's something that looks like 3PO, and then there's possibly the Wills. Yeah, no, I mean, that was really cool. Like, I'm curious, where this place was, what planet it was, what the significance of that is. Like, was there a battle there? Was this, some other Imperial outpost this goes back to our conversation about making the universe larger, not smaller. We've talked about judicious use of fan service, the deep cuts, but doing it in a very subtle way. And that kind of stuff is great because it's contextualizing the universe and it's stuff we're familiar with and we would fully expect to see, but it's not like, not like Rogue One where you bump into Ponda Baba and Dr. What's-His-Name. And you're like, that was a little too much. Anyway, I like the character Cobb. I like what they did with him in this episode. And yes, like you said, Jeff, I hope he shows up, often and is a big part of the Mando's crew, like Cara Dune and Greef Karga. But R5-D4, you poorly motivated piece of junk, get over here. That's just as bad as Special Edition Star Wars Episode 4, Boba Fett walking across the screen and then turning and looking at the audience.
So hear me out. A couple generations of kids that have not had the Jedi Order, and all of a sudden you get one Jedi, destroys both Death Stars, awesome, but word might not get out as quickly as you might think. Maybe some people aren't tuned in to the politics. Maybe some people aren't tuned in to what's really going on. If they don't have the technology, they're not going to get the information. So
then how does Pelly at the Mos Eisley spaceport know to thank the Force? When he's trying to describe what the child has done in his presence over the course of the first season, he can't.
Yeah, that's problematic. It's not so far away that everybody in the universe doesn't know what the Force is. There's a lot in this episode that is cool. Mm-hmm. And there's a lot that really scares me about what's coming up in the season, because are we going to get more of this, these problems that we're having with in-world continuity?
This was strictly Favreau writing and directing.
The biggest piece of fan service in this episode, I think, and probably the thing that upon further reflection, that excites me the most, and I was hoping that Jeff would have caught it, is the fact that Constable Zuvio is in this episode.
Yeah, I like the opening scene. And
Peg Warmer, no more. Peg no. And
my ultimate fear, perhaps not David's, but Sean, the ultimate fear is, please don't tie this to the sequel trilogy.
I don't mind the alien species from the sequel trilogy. Seeing a mixed crowd like that didn't bother me at all. I like the fact that we got a new species in the fight promoter guy or the club owner or whatever he is, the Cyclops.
Cyclops, yep.
Yeah, mm-hmm. So we hadn't seen that before in Star Wars. But yeah, you know, it's an underworld thing. It's probably an illegal fight.
Gorkoresh the Cyclops swears by the Gatra.
It's the civil rights organization for droids.
It is.
The L337 party.
That works in the meantime for a crime syndicate on Coruscant.
Oil baths are not free.
How in any way does that establish your credibility in the moment? I don't know.
Well, I mean, the guy didn't really have a lot of credibility to begin with. I mean, let's be honest.
True.
But to Jeff's point, using those pieces and those elements is fine as long as you're not trying to justify the sequel trilogy or trying to finish this show off after we've spent all this time caring about Baby Yoda and his development and his safety, dropping him off at Luke's training academy at the end of season 5 to ultimately be killed by Kylo Ren.
That's a bad day.
Well, that would be a very sad day. And I think they should steer an independent course.
I'm sure they're reaching in the bag and they're calling up, you know, Neil Scanlon, and they're like, hey, what do you got over there that we can use this week? And he's like, well, I got a little Constable Zuvio in my bag. Like, that's pretty much what they're doing. They're not trying to, I mean, the main characters are being reinvented, you know, or new things are being introduced for the main characters. But the fact that we're going on with, we're seeing the Tuskens, we're getting the texture, but we're doing it on a budget.
A lot of humans.
And Mos Pelgo is almost entirely human. There's one Weequay.
So as soon as he walks into the bar and he's like, Weequay, give me the blah, blah, like,
yeah.
That's kind of also a little rough for Mando to just roll into a bar and call you by your species name. Hey, Weequay, give me a beer. Like, wait, what?
Speaking of that scene, that was another issue that I had in this show. You know, we have this nice little standoff going on. Creatures coming down the main street. And then, hey, we're just hanging out by the door. Like, there's no beef between the two of us. Let's talk it out.
It's not every day that you see a crate dragon. I mean, crate dragon interrupts the conversation for sure.
Get back.
They were a little too collegial after the crate dragon passed.
Yes.
But the standoff was great. I've heard the stories. I know you're good at killing. I know you're not happy that I'm sitting here in the armor, so I figure only one of us is leaving. He's seen worse.
He's seen much worse.
And the drink is Spotchka. There's continuity for you.
We're talking about Beskar, and we're talking about, you know, the cultural inheritance of the Mandalorians. Din Djarin probably would have killed him over it. We're starting to see, you know, that there is this growth in the character or this change in the character where he's becoming more inclined to take a path that doesn't necessarily end in violence. It's not that he's avoiding violence or that he's afraid of violence or that he doesn't, he's somehow become a pacifist. He's finding that just he would rather be able to make his way as easily as possible, not to do certain things.
Maybe it's another drill.
If what we're seeing is true with the bringing in of all these other Mandalorians, then we're clearly going to be dealing with Mandalorians that don't wear their helmets all the time. And so we'll soften Din Djarin's adherence once an episode or twice an episode. He might pop his helmet off for a second. Then that would make Pedro Pascal happy and show again a character arc. So we'll see what happens with that.
I'm still treating that news as rumors, but I know that it would make the widow on Sorgan happy.
I agree with you, Jeff. I, anybody with half a brain would embrace the fact that you are now in the Disney universe. Your financial future is pretty much set. I get wanting to quote unquote act because you really can't underneath a mask, but you are the Mandalorian. When you're done acting, you get to go do celebrations for the rest of your life and get That's paid. Right.
The Mandalorian is the flagship of the Disney Empire right now. This is the one Star Wars property that every single Star Wars fan is thoroughly embracing and loving. Personally, I have praised Pedro Pascal and his physical performance as the Mandalorian, because you can tell what that character is thinking without ever seeing an expression, without ever seeing his eyes, you know, any of that. Yeah.
As we move towards the end of the episode, the second half is devoted to fighting the crate. It felt like a combination of Godzilla and Jaws.
And then a little bit of Dune for good measure.
Tremors. More Tremors.
This episode felt bigger and more expensive, and that's not always a good thing. But to my eyes anyway, it looked great.
No, for the most part, I thought the whole interaction with the dragon, like all that, I think that's where the budget went for the special effects in that episode. You know, the clouds of dust and the movement of the dragon and the spitting of the acidy vomit. Like all that stuff looked fine. It definitely felt like it had the biggest cast in it, right?
Yes.
Aside from the
aside
from the assault on the compound and at the end of episode of the first season's episode one. That's like the most people we've had on screen at any one time. The village, I think, had a lot of people.
It did.
And then you can tell there's more being, I guess, invested in these shows. Like you say, they're expanding things. Things are looking bigger. They're feeling more cinematic.
The Sand People are villains. You can't trust them. Neither of you are happy with them. I'm not happy with them. I don't like the portrayal. If you give the Sand People explosives, are they going to follow through and go kill the dragon, or are they going to destroy you? Creating a friendliness and a reasonableness didn't sit well with me.
I totally agree with that.
Yeah, I absolutely agree. I mean, it definitely diminishes the New Hope version of Tusken Raiders.
I would say episode 2. They kidnap Anakin's mother and torture her to death.
We saw them in A New Hope. They attack travelers, try and take their stuff. But we really get an idea of how savage they are in the prequels. In the Gunslinger episode, when Din Djarin's like, look, if you pay tribute to them, right, give them your binoculars, they won't kill you. You can kind of deal with these Tusken Raiders in one-off scenarios. They might be open to a little bit of a bribe to leave you alone or whatnot. Like, I get it. Now we've turned into this full thing. Like, we're all going to sit down and we're going to share these, whatever these smoking gourd things are that you drink. And even in this episode, you said the whole thing. I was expecting the double cross, because how does harvesting crate dragon pearls become a cultural thing if they don't know how to kill a crate dragon? Not unlike the Mandalorians, you have this great feat of physical strength and whatever against a larger opponent or a beast of some kind, and you gain honor and status in your tribe. They go to the cave and they're talking about it, and he's like, the Tuskens have figured out that it has a sleep pattern, and they know kind of when it's going to get hungry, and if they feed it, it'll sleep more, and Kong is happy and he doesn't ruin your village. Well, they figured out a way. They tie up the banthas to the stick. They wake it up for a minute. It comes out and eats, and it goes and leaves them alone. I was like, well, if they already know how to do that, what's going to happen next?
Right.
It could be a proxy for them, in keeping the off-worlders, in check. Hey, there's so many different ways you could have played that.
I did like that it went after the Tusken and not the Bantha. I thought that was pretty funny.
That was kind of funny, yeah.
And of course, Din Djarin, the hero, makes sure the Marshal gets to safety by hammering his backpack in the same way Han hammered Boba Fett's backpack in Return of the Jedi, swallowed by the beast, uses the rifle to get himself spit out, and then blows the back end off it. So how did you like the climax?
I thought it was good. I mean, it was a little predictable, after the first explosions didn't go off. But I mean, I did enjoy that part.
Yeah, no, I like the whole thing about him taking the big chunk of meat on the back of his speeder bike. I thought that was hilarious. And Baby Yoda's like all over it, checking it out. Yeah. Is that just food for the child? Or like, I don't know. But he's got the armor and a big old chunk of crate meat on the back of his speeder bike. It's just right on, man.
So scale of 0 to 10, 10 being best, ratings for the episode.
6.5, maybe a 7.
Six. And maybe.
All right. So you both scoring it above average.
there's a lot of fan service. There's a lot of montages. I didn't feel like it moved season one story. I honestly was bored part of the time.
You're not happy unless you have Imperials.
That too. Yeah, give me some more stormtroopers.
See, yeah, David wouldn't care if we went back to Tatooine and there was like 600 stormtroopers in the episode. He'd be like, "Oh, it was the greatest episode yet."
10 right there.
All yeah, right, exactly. It was a good episode, but it felt out of place, and especially as a premiere episode. This should have been episode 2 of season 2. Fan service was a little heavy-handed. And the things that I saw in this episode that I wanted more of, I didn't get. And the things that I wasn't really interested in, I got a whole lot of. So we're on Tatooine again and again and again. Makes me knock it down a little bit, but not bad at all.
Really enjoyed it. I agree with your points about not moving the main story along. And I am surprised that this was the first episode of season 2-8. I'll take it.
Our conversation about season 2's premiere has come to an end. Thank you to David and Sean for their time and effort. Thank you for listening. Check out other audio reviews on our channel and please subscribe.
Galactic Initiative is not authorized or endorsed by Lucasfilm Limited. The name Star Wars and all related materials are registered trademarks of Lucasfilm Limited, a subsidiary of the Walt Disney Company, all rights reserved. Galactic Initiative is a registered trademark, and other product and company names are trademarks of their respective holders. Use does not imply affiliation or endorsement.
I have spoken.